The allure of Hollywood, or self-invention, obsession and broken dreams. This is the masterpiece, Mulholland Drive.
It's such a tense scene, the way it's set up. But the most important thing about meeting, it should be about this actress that they're trying to make him cast, but it's not. It's about an espresso.
It's all, everything's there, like with Fire Water With Me, everything's there.
Yeah.
He's given to it on a plate for you to work it out. You just have to do a little bit of work to do it.
There's a man in back of this place. He's the one who's doing it. I can see him through the wall.
Welcome, listeners. As I drive down this dark, diverse highway and pause to pick up John Aitken and Bob Fleming from Prog to Who, trek this out and take your seats. We are on a journey of discovery into the imagery and mastery of Lynchian landscapes, the efflux of stories interwoven in a tapestry of films. This is The Lynch Mob. Thank you, listeners, for tuning in again to another Lynch Mob, and this movie is the 2001 Mulholland Drive.
Yeah,
the girl is still missing.
What's wrong?
I don't know who I am.
I wonder where you were going.
Mulholland Drive.
Come on, it'll be just like in the movies. We'll pretend to be someone else.
Silencio.
This is all an illusion.
The Lynch Mob's back in the room.
What is it back?
You're not picking easy stuff to watch, though, are you? it's all hard work, isn't it? There's lots of thought has to go into it.
Is there anything easy that's Lynch?
No, might be that straight story, that
straight
one.
Straight story, that's about it, isn't it?
But well, no, it's, Elephant Man as well, it's quite linear.
But it's oh my God, it's unreal, isn't it? Fucking hell.
I've watched it already twice within 2 weeks.
Yeah.
I'm sure you probably have, haven't you?
Yeah, you have to,
Yeah, yeah, you have to get an understanding of it. It's so good.
It's mind-blowing, because it's weird, because I've never seen this before, ever. And I just think, you know, this is just Twin Peaks, isn't it? Which kind of is, all it was meant to be. You know, a spin-off or whatever, and it totally has a vibe, which is cool, and then it goes somewhere else, and then you have to go back and watch it all again, because it just fucked your mind up on it.
Well, yeah, it's because it's non-linear, isn't it? It's so cleverly done that,
yeah,
you know, whereabouts is the beginning of the film, and is the end of the film?
Well, that's
and
it.
You've got the ballpark of the story that the people think it's a dream she's having, and she's going through these emotions due to the fact that she's had a hitman put out on a girlfriend because she was jealous of, you know, the way she was manipulating men to get her to a different position. And then she, in the story, a lot of people believe she shot herself and that was the end of the film. But that happens at the end, and all what happens at the beginning, which she didn't really know for 2/3 of the film, is it a story? Is it a dream?
Right.
What's the end bit?
Are you trying to imply that, like, after she shoots herself, this is after that? The dream sequence is set after
what
that?
What I'm saying is, when she reaches for the gun, did you see what's in the drawer? There's a box, a blue box.
Yeah.
The blue box was in her dream as a blue box. It was never in the real world, the blue box. Because blue box was, I think, what she had to connect... with the key.
Fucking hell. How quick have we gone down the rabbit fucking hole? Jesus.
I'll tell you what I think. I'll tell you, this is the way I've seen it. And I've only seen it twice. I think I need to watch it again and again, really. Because it can change. Is that... So, you got the intro of the dance sequence.
Yeah.
And I think, and I don't know, that is Diane. So, we've got Diane and Betty, haven't we?
Yeah.
And I think that's Diane's childhood memory and her parents. It's all nice. And then you've got the shot of the person breathing under the blanket. Now, I think that's Diane going into a dream. And I think that's sort of the end of the film is the beginning, because you've got... I think that's the real life, that bit there. The Diane bit's real life. So So she's fallen in love with this actress, you know, Camille.
Camilla, yeah.
But she's the one that's the star kind of thing. And then she falls in love with Adam, the director. She's hurting and she's a bit mental and horrible. And it's Hollywood, the horrible side of Hollywood, or the real side of Hollywood. And then she puts a hitman to kill Camilla. And then she can't handle the guilt. And she goes this whole process. And one way she tries to process it before suicide or not is to go into this whole, like, you know, dream. Hence, when you go into the main part of the film, for example, if she's coming down the stairs, she's got that very false, over-the-top smile, like, welcome to Hollywood, yeah, you know, yeah, kind of thing. Yeah. And she's trying to put it right in her dream. So that's where I'm coming at it from. And then you go through all this dream sequence until they get to the silent centaur or whatever, the theatre.
Yeah.
And that's when things get shaky in the dream. So then it goes back to the beginning, if that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah.
But whether she commits suicide or not, you don't know really, do you? That's the way I perceive it. Obviously, you've got the box, and the box is, I don't know, it's one of his metaphors, isn't it, for something with the blue key. And I mean, that's just very basic kind of, if it was linear, how I would think of it.
Very basic. Very basic.
No, but you know what I mean? Like, I mean, you've got loads, cause you've got loads of bits in, like, when they are in the end bit, you've got stuff like she's wearing a dressing gown. So it's kind of like she's thinking back as well at this point as well. So it's reality with her having a flashback, because when she's on top of her, she suddenly has just a hot pant, you know, hot pants on when she's on top of Camille and they're making love or whatever.
Yeah.
Because it cuts from her having a dressing gown to her not, and then it keeps going to this dressing gown thing. There's different things on the table as well.
Yeah.
So at one point there's an ashtray, the next point there's somewhere else. Then you have the point where the blue key's on the table, so she knows it's done, the hit, and all this kind of stuff. So you've got all that element of it as well. It's a fucking mindfuck, man. It's awesome. Awesome.
Right. Oh, glad you enjoyed it.
Is it my turn?
Yeah, it's your turn.
My turn. Right. So Diane Selwyn wins a jitterbug competition, and she's got sort of stars in her eyes and fancies going to Hollywood. That all of that is a dream. All of that is what she's dreaming that night. You see the very first scene, she puts her head on the pillow, and that dream has taken all the parts of her real life that happened after that, like the dinner party, and her just life being shit and all the bullshit she has to deal with.
Yeah.
And that entire dream sequence reflects real life. It takes people in that she's seen in the diner where she selected her plan. He just appears in her dream as somebody else, the whole character. And each one of these things, because she's dreaming it, each one of these characters is an aspect of her.
Yeah.
So the director is an aspect of her. It's her sort of ambition and want it, and not giving in to like the corrupt, but eventually giving in to the corrupt. The whole mafia kind of people at the back are this is the way she imagines that she can justify what she's doing. The justification for Camilla getting the roles that she wanted, because she's a failed actress. So this is like an excuse that's been stuck in the story for her. All these things happen in the dream sequence, which reflects what we're doing. The blue box, I think, is just the path from the dream to wakefulness. And that's why, kind of blue has quite a significant meaning through the whole film. Like when she's in the dream, she's wearing pink and she's innocent, and Betty is innocent and lovely, and it's over the top.
Yeah.
She gets off in Hollywood at the airport, and she's like met at the, and she has these lovely doddery old people that are the same people that you see in the jitterbug scene at the start. So they're her grandparents.
And at the end as well, they've gone.
And at the end. And when they're driving away in the taxi, looking evil and grinning. It's because they are evil.
Terrifying, that bit.
But they're away from Betty at that point, and therefore they return. They're away from Betty's fantasy.
Yeah.
So therefore they've like returned to their evil ways. I think the grandparents abused her in some way. And also the jitterbug thing, you only see the light centered on her cheering that she won.
Yeah.
It's a jitterbug competition. She had to have had a partner. But the partner's nowhere to be seen. Because this is all about Betty.
Yeah.
This is all about her. It's all about Diane and her dreams and her fantasy about how it should have been to her.
Hmm.
And then we get none of that. And then she kills herself at the end. But like, it's like a fractured, it's a weird fractured thing that happens to her, because once the dream has happened and she wakes up on that bed, she sees the key. So as you say, she knows that the hitman's been successful. And then she has a fantasy about having sex with Camilla again.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And she has a masturbation scene that truly traumatised her, I think, as an actress. And then, like, the grandparents coming into a room and pushing her onto the bed, sort of implying the sexual abuse thing again.
Yeah.
That is her guilt crushing her, and then she kills herself, and that's the end of the film.
Do you think that she did commit suicide at the end?
Yeah, yeah.
You did?
Yeah.
Well, but let me just put in one point of view, because there's so many different things, isn't there? So,
yeah, no.
So number one is you got the blue box within her drawer, which only existed between that was the other reality of her dream world.
That's the key part to it, though, is the blue box being in her drawer with a gun.
Yeah, yeah.
That was when she saw the blue box. She knew that she would be going for the gun at some point. She knew she was going to kill herself. She saw it in a dream when she sees her own body.
Yeah. I mean, I must admit, first viewing, like, when you're just watching this film, you're thinking, oh, Twin Peaks, cool, it's quirky. It's funny. It's really funny. It's really tense. It's all these things. It's fucking brilliant, but it is Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
And then suddenly that blue box, it starts getting a bit surreal. Again, Twin Peaks, the theatre. And then suddenly that blue box bit, you're like, oh, fuck, here we go. Here we go. And it's just like, what the fuck's going on? It's like, just totally throws you. Especially if you're not used to Lynch. Like, I'm not really. You know, I've started on my journey.
Yeah.
So I didn't, I just was like, oh my God, this is mental. And then when you watch it again and you've got the end bit in your head, and I can watch it again and again. And fucking hell, it's just.
I think there's, like all these films, there's so many different layers and different ways to interpret
it. Yeah, there are.
But there's box. There's also different the significance of a box. Now you've got a blue-haired lady sat in a box in the theatre. So could she be a key within the box of which she's thinking of death? The woman with the blue hair, could that be her auntie, the roof? Could she be one connected with the roof? What you see? You do see her at the end.
Auntie Ruth's dead, isn't she? In the latter reality.
Yeah.
She said about her aunt's dead, didn't she?
Yeah,
so I don't know if that's got something bad.
Yeah.
And she's like, you know, she's the one that's letting her stay at her house and things like that.
I think Aunt Ruth is the good thing about her life.
Right.
That's why her fantasy is her going to Aunt Ruth's place.
Yeah.
But Auntie Ruth is dead.
The thing is, I don't know if you picked up on when they went to the club, they speak in three different languages, French, Spanish and English.
Yeah.
Spanish for the Spanish girl, Camilla, English for the Diane, and French. Now, this is where I thought there might be a connection to
the theatre.
To the theatre or to Auntie as well, who might be the woman with the blue hair.
I don't know if it's more practical than that. Sorry, John.
Theatre is a French word, isn't it?
Yeah.
So.
And I was going to say, it might be more practical than that because this was if it wasn't for French people, this would never have been made. It was Pierre, whatever he was called, and another
French guy.
Oh, yeah,
put the money for it, yeah.
That put the money up for it after it was, put on a shelf by ABC because they didn't like it as a pilot. Because it was meant to be, in theory, a spin-off to Twin Peaks, based on Twin Peaks in LA. Audrey had gone to LA, kind of thing, and then off from there.
Yeah.
But obviously they didn't like it. So then these French guys came in. So it's kind of a French film, really.
Yeah,
from a production point of view.
I think he does have quite a lot of connection with France, doesn't he, as well? He's like does his own gallery stuff over there, and he goes over there quite often. To be honest, a lot of his films, not to put an international gap on it, but a lot of his films I find quite heavily towards the European, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The way they feel very like European films and German films.
It's odd, particularly because it's a lot of his stuff is so rooted in Americana.
Yeah.
To still have a European flavour is a bit weird.
I think it's a reflection on the way, and we sort of touched on it last time when we did Fire Walk With Me, is that America not America, but the Hollywood aspect of things aren't very welcoming to David Lynch, are they? And networks and things like that. I think he's always struggled with that element. For example, Gene.
Yeah.
Things like that, and I think that's why his preference or artistic preference is more leaning towards international.
I'm not completely saying that she is dead or isn't dead, yeah. By the looks of the film, it looks like she committed suicide. But one last thing, which might just throw it on that side, or at least give you open the doors, is the blue-haired lady is a product of her imagination and dream world. The blue-haired lady still appears after she dies. And then the smoke fills the room, and the blue-haired lady starts saying silencio, didn't she?
The tramp behind Winkies is there at the same time as well, after she's dead. So, I mean, that's why I'm not so sure about that.
Well, there's a few different other theories on it. Oh, one thing I need to bring up as well, because I've got it written down, right? If I don't say it, I'm going to fucking forget it, right? The man, Dan, who's in the diner.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Oh, man, yeah. That'll... Tell you what, that diner scene was absolutely chilling for me all the way through.
The first, yeah.
Frightening. Frightening.
Fucking scared the shit out of me, because it was kind of lulling along, wasn't it? Obviously, after you've had the crash and that, lulling along, and then suddenly, it's the most scary thing I've ever seen in my life.
That's a hell of a jump scare, but it's even better because they're telling you all the way what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He says, this is what happened. And then he suddenly leads you there and you still jump because it's so well done.
It was, yeah. And
all of it. When he's describing, when Ben, is it Ben or is it Dan?
Dan.
But Dan. When Dan's explaining to his mate, like, what the dream is, the way it's phrased, the actual words he's using are like, you can always see it like when Lynch does something properly, as soon as something important is being said, you really know that something important is being said. There's a man in back of this place, the one who's doing it. I can see him through the wall.
Did you not think he was talking about himself as a director?
Yep, I've written down here, it's just Lynch referring to himself.
Exactly what I thought, because especially on the back of Twin Peaks season 3, etc. I don't want to spoil anything for you, Bob, but it just makes you feel of that, doesn't it? If you hadn't seen that, I probably would have thought about this smelly old tramp in the back. But because I've watched the other bit, I'm thinking he's talking about David Lynch. That's how I feel.
Yeah, but I don't think the tramp is David.
No.
The tramp's the Wicked Witch of the West.
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't it quite clear?
Oh, it's proper, like, because you say, like I said, this is nice. This feels like Twin Peaks. I know this now. It's just, what the fuck is that? Like, proper made me jump.
So, the Wizard of Oz, there's quite a few references in this film, I think, to the Wizard of Oz I've read.
Yeah.
She Betty lands in Hollywood like Dorothy lands in Oz. Dorothy takes the yellow brick road, she takes a yellow taxi. Characters from the real world, from Diane's real world, in the fantasy, in different roles.
Yeah.
Just like there are.
Yeah, Coco.
There's the Oz. Winkies. Yeah, Coco, Winkies. Yeah. The citizens of the Wicked Witch of the West's part of Oz.
Oh, they're called Winkies. God, I never picked up on that one.
And the witch just looks, the Wicked Witch of the West looks like that tramp, big nose and all that stuff.
Fucking hell.
But they also, did you not get the reference to the old film Sunset Boulevard? Have you ever seen it? 1950s film.
I might have seen it years ago, but I don't remember.
There's a musical version, but if you get the original version, 1950s one, this woman, Norma Desmond, now she's a star of the silent films, and she's trying to make it into the talkies, but she's too old. She's being passed over. She's not what they were looking for. And it was one of the first films to really show how Hollywood just will wash away stars when they want. It's like, I've had enough of this star now, go for the next one. And then it's the aftermath of that star. And you can sort of see that within these parallels of this film, where what happens to those stars you see from those, maybe a movie you watched 3 years ago and she don't pop up anymore. But she is probably working in that diner, which probably pops up every time.
So just go from the get-go, really. Obviously, we talked about the winning of the competition.
Yeah.
And then into the dream. It's quite a quick scene, and it's a groovy little scene as well. The music's really cool as normal. It's like quite happy.
It's really upbeat for his type of films, isn't it?
It's nice. And then, and then
is that the jitterbug?
Yeah, And then you go into the. Sorry, John.
No, carry on. That's kind of like, that's her favourite memory of her life, when she won something and she was top dog and everything.
Just as your first time watching it, like, you know, the first time you experience, it's like, oh, it's quite nice, this and all that. And then you get into the bit with the car and the gun, and then, you know, there's that, and he sort of says, get out. And it's so full on, them two cars with kids coming out.
Yeah.
You know, like, and I've noticed this as well more and more with Lynch, because he's the music he puts to them. is genius, and how he does it, and it adds to everything to do with the film. Nothing's wasted, everything's thought out, and the rise in the mix of the volume is like, and it really happens at the end. It goes fuck. He's whoa. Yeah. Do you like when you watch some films and you've got your TV on not a great volume, so the dialogue sometimes goes a bit missing, then it goes to a big boom boom bit. You can't help that. With this, it's all intentional. So that was like, and then fucking hell, and then she gets out the car and all that, and he directed it and he said, act like a broken dolly, act like a broken doll. So that's why she's sort of like, rather than say stunned and dazed, he's just basically directing in a metaphor all the time with her. And oh, he does it with all his actors.
He can't help himself, can he? But
they all say like it works, because you immediately know what kind of what that would look like in your imagination. And then she sort of nimble bimbles down and all that, and then it's all kind of very Twin Peaks. The cops, it's got, what's his name, out of series three, isn't it, on it?
Yeah. As a detective. Robert Forster, yeah.
And then you sort of, then off you go, kind of thing. I just think I just want to get to a couple of my favourite scenes, if I can.
Yeah.
My first one is just that bit where he goes to do the hit on that long-haired dude. So he's there, and he's their mates and all that kind
brilliant.
Of stuff. Brilliant. It's so fucking funny. And then just shoots him, you're like, fuck. And then the comedy begins when he's trying to clean off the gun, and then he shoots through the wall. This woman starts screaming. He runs, a massive, huge woman. She's like, Sam, that just bit me. She's
been shot. That's her only role. That's her only role on IMDb is heavyset woman.
Well,
on Mulholland Drive.
I mean, I don't know if he's like renowned for it, but he got a lot of his mates just to come in and act. So it might have been one of his mates, because the cowboy.
The cowboy was his mate.
It's amazing, but it's his friend Monty, just his mate. And he said, "I'll come and do this." And he couldn't. He couldn't learn lines. He wasn't an actor. So they had to put a massive board for him, but he needed glasses. So he couldn't read them. So he's like, but he just, that's what he wanted. That's what he wanted the cowboy to be, his mate.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like spooky, and it stops for a bit with a caretaker, with a Hoover.
Yeah.
And he's like, come here, help me, ring the ambulance. Da, da, da. Then fucking goes in the room, like sets it all up like the guy that's killed himself, shot his people and killed himself. And then fucking shoots him, the alarm goes. It was just absolutely slapstick, hilariously funny.
You know, it reminded me of
the Lynch way.
It reminded me of The Man Bites Dog, what we all watched.
Yeah, very much, that's exactly.
Dark humour. And it's really funny. Very, very clever.
Well, I think that's Betty's wishful thinking.
Yeah.
That the assassin that she's paid for is crap.
And you might fuck it up.
And she's dreaming having been absolutely the worst crim ever.
Yeah.
And it's quite interesting as well that the assassin's got short blonde hair and the person that he killed had long dark hair.
Yeah.
Like the Camilla thing as well. And it's another thing about the colour theory thing as well, the black book that has Camilla's address in it that he's after for this kill. Whenever you see somebody in a black dress, they're kind of like, something's dark going on, like red dress for sexual stuff. And
yeah.
It's just one of those Lynch films that just takes every single thing is there for a reason.
Well, the killer as well, when she's in the dream side, he has two different coloured eyes. Are the different coloured eyes supposed to represent Camilla and her? One's blue and one's brown. And then he's actually, when she's sat in winking, they're both blue. Blue meaning death.
I didn't realise that.
But blue is his natural eye colour for that actor as well. So he purposely placed in a dark contact lens.
Yeah.
And you could fill the books just trying to figure out what the hell is he doing there. Because obviously, again, Lynch has done it on purpose. Is it because she can't remember the colour of his eyes? Or is it because of both of them?
I think that might be, now that you mentioned that, that might be the fact that he both exists as that character in both the dream and in reality.
Yeah, yeah. And therefore it has the both.
So he's got, the blue is the transformative thing. So he's both, because he's the only character in it, really, that doesn't have a different
role.
I mean, perhaps aside from the director.
Yeah.
A different role.
Who doesn't have a different role in her dream than he does in reality.
Weird. Awesome, that, John. I was going to say, my other sort of scene, face value scene, you can watch it as it's a funny scene, is the bit where they go to the meeting in the for the studio for the actress with the mafia guys come in.
Yeah.
And it's such a tense scene, the way it's set up. But the most important thing, that meeting, it should be about this actress that they're trying to make him cast, but it's not. It's about an espresso. And the guy that drinks the espresso, that's Angelo.
Yeah.
What's he called? Angelo.
Badalamenti.
Yeah, that's him.
Yeah, yeah.
and he doesn't act. He's been in bits playing piano, you know, in the background, but he doesn't act. And it's because he told this story to David Lynch about going around someone's house, and he didn't really know him, and he was invited by this bloke's wife, and they went, and he never said anything for half an hour, and he's trying to engage him in conversation, and he's just looking at him like that, you know, like he does the look.
Yeah.
He said he was just, David Lynch remembered this story, and that's why he asked him to do it. So, and it's just so good, and the whole tension behind this espresso thing. It's so fun. It's like the most important thing in the world. It's a tiny little coffee.
It's brilliant.
And he comes in, he drinks it, he just spits it out, and then they just go fucking savage. That guy goes savage. It's fucking brilliant. I just think it blew my mind that I just was like, because I was so tense, that I was laughing my head off.
Yeah.
And that guy went mental.
I've got two favourite scenes in this entire thing. First is the diner scene, because it's just the first one with
Dan
yeah. and the because that's just chillingly brilliant. And the second is the audition scene. Where she's auditioning for the role.
I got lots of
That is a great scene because she's acting somebody who's having the audition of her life, and she's like this. She totally nails the audition, and it's a switcheroo he plays as well. It does Lynch, because all the way up to then you've pictured Diane, Betty as naive, innocent. You expect her to be manipulated. You expect her to be groped by this old weird actor.
Yeah.
But what happens is she turns out that no, she's the one that grabs his hand and puts it on her ass. She completely fucking.
Yeah. She dominates. She dominates that role where you would have thought this old actor would have
done. I mean, when I watched that scene the first time as well, I was just like, that's why, not knowing the ending and everything like that. So that's why Naomi Watts has got this role, because that is one of the most stunning performances by any actor I've ever seen on a TV screen.
Also to switch like that as an actor as well. You know, you always hear about these actors getting himself into a role, and you get like Christian Bale, and he does certain things to get himself totally into a role, and he's quite rude on set apparently and stuff like that. And then you see Naomi Watts. So she's played this like happy-go-lucky, very typical, what you'd say, typical blonde person from the middle of nowhere, and she's come to this set, and like John says, instantly at that point she switches it over. Even as an actress doing that, that's an amazing role.
So Betty's come to America. She's gone to LA. She's been there a week. She's got an audition. She nails it. This is like success on every level. She's destined for stardom. She goes to see that director. He turns and falls in love with her. And the only reason she doesn't get the part or whatever is because...
The mafia.
Yeah.
There's some
whatever,
unnamed conspiracy that she's made up in her mind that denies her. And it's just such an amazing... This is the number one... BBC Culture voted this number one film of the 21st century.
Did it?
Wow.
Yeah, literally top of the list.
Wow.
And it's won many accolades, and it's certainly, and I'm not saying this with any hyperbole at all, but it's my favourite film of all time now.
Wow!
I mean, it totally is.
It was mind blowing.
It is very for sure. I tell you a little tidbit. You know, Billy Ray, who's in it, and that was one of his first acting roles. And David Lynch says, "Well, I'll do this role." He blames David Lynch for having Miley Cyrus's fame. Because he says his daughter watched him in the role, and it pushed her on to wanting to be an actress herself, and it got her opening the doors for that Hannah Montana what she was in, and now look at her now.
It's no longer my favorite. It's no longer my favorite film now. You've ruined David Lynch for me.
But I love that.
You can't ruin
there's
it
some
for me.
Cracking laugh out loud moments when there's that part when the fucking big ass mafioso, or connected with some, you know, the elites or the kings of Hollywood, walks in to try and find the director, and then she's jumping on his head, and Billy Ray comes out, Dante gives him some shit, and he just one smack to him with the woman above. You think, what's he gonna do? He just smacks her as well, and then he walks off to try and find. And that's the only scene really that guy's in it, apart from a little bit at the beginning.
Yeah.
You're thinking, what on earth has just gone on?
It's coming. I think there's a few great laugh out loud moments. Like what John was saying there, it's with all his accolades and that. And I'm not a David Lynch buff. I'm learning and learning and learning and loving the journey. But this is, from what I've seen of David Lynch as a person, because I've been watching a lot of his interviews and things, This is a perfect reflection of him. You know, there's joy, there's this tension, there's the depth, there's everything in this film is him. I can see why people adore working with him and what they say about him and things like that, because he's not freeing from the point of view as in the lines are the fucking lines, you know, because he's written them, he's thought it out. He knows this in his head how it's going to go. But the joy and freedom he brings to the actors and actresses. So, for example, the scene, the masturbation scene. Obviously, Naomi Watts, she was like, it was like horrendous. She had a bad belly. She kept having to go to the toilet because she was so nervous. So he put this sort of big screen around her so no one else could see her. And he was outside with a megaphone, you know, shouting, it's okay, it's okay. And she was getting really mad, like, can't believe you're making me do this and all this kind of stuff. But it all paid off. And she did that because of the way he takes care of the actors and how he deals with just people in general. If you're saying something bad, he makes it the most positive thing in the world. They were saying someone the other day, I forgot something on set one day and the actor held up shooting. And he went, no, I'm happy to wait, little break, you know, this kind of stuff. Whereas other people were like, fucking, nah, you know, jump down the throat and things like that.
Well, it's a difference between a proper artist director and one that's a studio director that's there to churn out a movie.
Yeah,
for the maximum profit.
Yeah. It's making a piece of art, and he said before in an interview, art can be music, art can be film, and you know, once he's done the film, that's the piece of art. And then that's one of the reasons he doesn't like talking or explaining the films, because he said the art's finished. Yeah. It's up to you to interpret it. The art's done. If I start to move the film back into words, then what's the point of having the film?
And it's right. Yeah. It's absolutely spot on. It's like me. It's like anything, like art-wise, music, painting, whatever. It's what you have, your own personal preference. If you listen to a song, it's a special song to you. It's a special song for a reason to you, not, you know, whatever else. The majority of films, the majority of linear, normal, like churned out films, are, you know, they are what they are. What is the plot? There's not really any hidden depth to it or anything like that. But that's why this is art.
It's obscured, but it's all everything's there. Like with Firewalk With Me, everything's there.
Yeah.
He's given to it on a plate for you to work it out. You just have to do a little bit of work to do it. It's like the difference between having something, like the analogy is a hamburger against a fillet steak.
Yeah.
One's very easy and consumable and not very worth anything. And the other is something you have to, you know, you have to get a bit more.
There's that within this film as well. We could have a look at the character Coco.
Yeah.
Yeah, because...
Sounds very much like Toto, doesn't it?
Well, her name is Coco Lenoir. I hope I said that right. Yeah. Lenoir means nut in French.
Yeah.
So coconut.
Coconut.
Yeah, she's sat on the table, she's constantly eating walnuts.
That's the reasoning behind her naming in the fantasy.
Yeah.
Is because of that small snippet of that dinner party where Diane... Caesar, and therefore, bang, that's it. That's how Lynch gets his ideas as well, ironically enough. He'll be there, and something will just go ping into his mind.
Yeah, yeah.
And he'll know what to do.
Yeah, just put it both together.
That's kind of how he does it.
Well, he sort of said about this when he got approached, you know, about making it into a film from being shelled as a pilot. And he was like, he didn't have any ideas. And he went into his meditation, and in meditation, it all came to him, the how to make it into the film. I mean, thank fuck it didn't get picked up as a TV series, because...
Well, you say that, but I imagine it would have been a fantastic TV series.
Yeah, but I just think you would never have had Mulholland Drive, which is just incredible, man.
Well, it probably would have gone on for, like, I don't know, back in them days, 10, 12 episodes. It would have been 12 hours long.
More. Yeah. Well, the original edit, because his wife edits it, I think, and she does the first edit kind of thing, because she knows roughly what he wants, because it's all there. And the first cut of this was 5.5 hours, so that's basically everything in it that she thinks he's gonna need to strip it out. She sort of does it for him. She does like a really long version. This one was 5.5 hours of film. I'd love to see that. Be cool.
Yeah, well, it's so similar to Firewalk With Me. It was over 5 hours as well, wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, the first lovemaking scene is very beautiful, as in it's lovely. You feel genuine love and it feels right.
Yeah.
You know, and all that kind of thing. It's very tender. It's lovely.
Yeah, it's very tender.
It's also very one-sided, isn't it? It's Diane, it's Betty telling Rita. She loves her.
Yeah.
But Rita's not saying it back, because that's... When you can see as well that Camilla out of the dream sequence is a complete bitch. She's just there trying to make it, you know, she's just like making out with people in front of her. She knows.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, she's.
That,
yeah.
She's just a complete bitch. But she even invites her to the party so that she can announce that she's going to get married. And that's why that trip in the limousine is seen as an ambush kind of thing, like in the dream sequence. Yeah. It's Rita who's getting ambushed.
Yeah.
And that's where she'll think that everyone's against her, especially the longing kiss which Camilla does to the blonde, well, the actress as well.
She's the one that gets the role as well, isn't she?
Yeah,
in the
that's
film.
Right.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my
and
god!
And she's kind of unnamed, but she turns up in the as this mysterious Camilla Rhodes in the fantasy because she just was in there for a few seconds.
Yeah,
yeah.
And like the cowboy was just a passing person in the back of the party, and yet he played a quite important part.
Yeah,
cowboy was amazing. I love when Lynch puts in the sort of the log lady kind of thing. You know, the sort of exposition, yeah, but not quite exposition, and. It adds a bit of a bit of like unknowing to it, like what's he, yeah, you know, what's, yeah, he got, you try to look into, it's what like, he's saying, and
exactly, he's like the
mysterious, they always speak in
side,
riddles, don't they? Yeah. They always speak in riddles as well.
And yeah, it was just like, what's he on about? I just love that little stuff, and the people he gets to play him as well. Like I said, it was his mate Monte, and it's just because he thought that's what I want him to be like, and it'll be cool, and it was awesome. And apparently his cowboy gear was owned by, I can't remember who it was. I think it was a famous cowboy actor, and he spent thousands on this gear. So he turned up with his own gear that he bought to play this cowboy. It must have been because that he wore this gear, had this cowboy gear, and he had this certain voice that Lynch thought, oh, he'd be great for it kind of thing. But it's funny. It's just cool, man. That's the beauty of art and freedom, is the fact that you don't have to have a big name. It can be your mate.
Yeah.
You know, if you're in that position and you feel they're going to be right for the part, it can be your mate, and it's great.
Yeah, I think he does that. He goes for the look. Apparently, some of the things he does is just simply look at the person, David Lynch. So he'll know what body of work they've done, or even not any work, and he just looks for the look. The guy in the hotel, that crummy hotel, with the moustache, same guy in the theatre as well.
Oh, yeah.
He wears all in red. Well, the reason he got him to do the theatre part was he turned up to do that bit at the hotel, and he didn't have a bust up with David Lynch, but he just was wanting a little bit more. David, as he was driving home, he got a phone call from David Lynch to say, come back, I want you for another role. And he went back, he says, what, I'm going to be this other person? He goes, yeah, but it's actually your role. That's your night job. So in the night job, you work in the theatre, and the day job, you work in the hotel.
Man,
and he did that for him because he thought, oh, I'll give him a bit extra. I'll get him to do this.
Yeah. That's class.
That's a brilliant thing. That's a nice touch, that, to hear.
He was with Naomi Watts and Laura Harring, and they both went for their audition separately. Now, Lynch had a photograph, Naomi Watts, portfolio photo. She had makeup on and all that kind of thing. And it's one of the prerequisites of going to a Lynch casting, is that you don't wear makeup kind of thing, and you look plain, you know, that sort of... But she came in with no makeup on and that, and he was like, you don't look like your photo. And she was like, whoa. So he asked her to come back again, you know, to look like her photo. And then they asked her back for a screen test. But he said, he sort of said, this isn't a screen test. This is a filter test, you know, check the filters and all this kind of stuff. So it's a bit of a strange one for her. But when Laura went, she went with the no makeup on and that kind of thing. And he just sat in a chair and just went, good. Good, very good. But basically just looked at her and tried to imagine her, you know, playing the role and all that. And that's it. That was it.
I think he has a vision, though.
Yeah.
He's got to have this look. It doesn't matter what background you got. You could be Brad Pitt status as an actress, or you could be just come through the acting school, or even just someone he meets in a diner. If you've got that look for his thing, it puts you in.
To him, there's no such thing as a sort of mistake. It's always like an opportunity for something. An idea might come from anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's the Bob Ross of films, isn't he? Really?
He is. Like, you're the Bob Ross
no
of wood.
No such thing as a happy accident.
Yeah, like you're the Bob Ross of wood, John.
Yeah, as if.
But that element's super cool because that is art. You know, it's based on look and how it makes you feel. You know, that's what I always perceive any art to be, or how it sounds and how it makes you feel. But he combines the three elements of sort of, you know, screen, visual, music, you know, and it into this. Just it's just perfection. I mean, you know, how he does it, so the visual script and music all together.
Yeah,
it's just absolutely perfect and triumphant.
And talking about music, the female singer in the club.
Oh.
How much? I I'm a big lad, but my God, I was filling up tears on that one.
Well, that
he knows how to do it to you. Does Lynch? He knows how to manipulate the audience.
Beautiful, beautiful.
And again, I don't know her name, but
Rebecca Del Rio. Her name is
Rebecca Del Rio.
Yeah.
But he's got a friend who's a music agent, and so basically, he always recommends someone who thinks he'd be suitable for music in his films or whatever. And he put her forward, got her a taxi, because Lynch has got his own studio at his house. So pulled up in a taxi, walked in, 5 minutes in the studio, recorded that. That was the song you heard on the screen. It was just, that was it, literally 5 minutes in there, done.
There's something to be said about spontaneity, and I think that's what he likes about these things.
But I think she was that good that it was just like, fuck it. Because it is. It's an amazing vocal performance. And then you have that in this very surreal scene.
Yeah.
Because that's when it turns, really, isn't it? To the more surreal. You've got the guy coming out and conducting the imaginary orchestra, which I think is brilliant, because he's sort of doing it with his hands. He's in control.
But you know, it's a magician's performance. It's a magician. Yeah. He didn't tell you what he's doing. It's like Lynch explaining his films. He's like, he's doing it, and once the magician's done it, he doesn't tell you how it's done, does he?
No.
He lets you try and work it out.
And then you've got the trumpet guy, you know, coming out with the trumpet mute man and all that kind of stuff. And then Betty, as she's in this part, starts shaking in a chair. Now, I think this is where she's doing that, because this is where the dream starts coming apart.
Yeah, yeah.
And then suddenly you've got this fucking song, and like you're saying there, Cliff, like you're just...
Oh, you're so emotionally connected with the film at that point.
And it's just a voice.
Yeah.
It's just a voice. Mm. That is the only thing in the music, but it's such a beautiful voice. And then that's cutting between these two, acting their socks off, because they're both brilliant actors.
Yeah.
You know, doing the crying scene, and this is where it's all coming apart. But you don't know that yet. You know, you don't know that yet. And it's just, fucking hell. I was in bits as well. Yeah.
But the man on the theatre does tell you straight away, this is all an illusion. And I think that's when she started to trigger, like, what? And he goes, this is all fake, this is all illusion. And she's only miming the tune, and then she falls down and collapses. And that's when she's starting to think, oh, something. And then there's the lady in the box, the blue hair as well.
It's not the first time that she's tried to tell herself in her dream that this is all a dream, because there's that woman turns up at the apartment, doesn't
Yeah,
there?
Yeah.
And she says, I'm Betty. And she says, you're not.
Crazy Louise.
And
Crazy Louise. And like... And then Coco, who was part of a dream, takes her away so that Betty can carry on with her fantasy.
Yeah.
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 It's just so clever.
Well, she tries desperately to do it throughout that period where they're starting to hunt down this person, because when she rings Diane, and she's ringing herself, and she's like, oh, isn't it strange ringing herself? And she started saying to picture herself as a separate person at that point. So that's when a real subconscious probably trying to take over, probably trying to wake her up.
There was that scene where Rita's cutting her own hair, cutting her hair and changing herself to blonde. And I noticed, like, when they put the scissors down, they put them very specifically down on a book.
Yeah.
A blue book. Again, the colour blue, indicating, like, this is a transformation happening. And this is when she's starting to... It's all starting to unravel, because she's starting to notice that Rita is her, as well as Betty is her.
Yeah.
Like everybody in the film is her.
Yeah. You can see that within the diner as well. The diner is so important to the film, because she looks up at the girl, and if you have to double take. Is it that you're like, is that Diane? Is that actually the actress? Is that Naomi Watts? You've got the hair more or less the same as well. And like you said, it's also her desperately trying to control Camilla in her fantasy, isn't she? Like, to her, having amnesia is the perfect gift. It's like she can manipulate how she wants now.
I think she looks, I think Naomi Watts looks very, not very different, but it feels, it's obviously a different character, but I think she looks different, you know, in the what we call reality, the end bit.
Yeah.
I think she does look very different. It's the, yeah, not
she
just
doesn't
a
have
hair.
Any makeup on.
Right.
Basically, it's like that, isn't it? She doesn't have any makeup on. She's not done. She doesn't take care of herself. Her hair's dirty. Went all the way through the film. It was beautiful and clean and perfect all the time.
But this, she
never anything bad.
She really associated with the part, you know, because she said this is a proper reflection on Hollywood, you know, kind of thing, and how they are.
Yeah.
And she's experienced that all of her career, if you like, until you've made it big or making it big. And the one thing David Lynch, you know, that this is why she absolutely adores and loves David Lynch. You will see that in every interview that she does. And she will always work for him no matter what. Hence she came back in, you know, Twin Peaks or came into Twin Peaks. That she just broke down crying, saying like he treats you like just a very special person, or there's no bullshit. It's just so lovely, and the way he gets performances out of everyone, it's just it's not just his awesome genius and things like that, but it's just he's a nice bloke.
Yeah,
and he makes you feel the next level. You know, like and you feel it takes you to the next level as well, and that's what. Pretty much every actor you see speak about him says, and Naomi, she literally broke down in this interview crying, and he was like comforting her and stuff like that because that's what he did, you know, for her. And that's beautiful. That's
really good. You can see that in his work, can't you, as well? Because, like I said before, if someone's putting up the money for a film and they turn around, the bit reflecting. I think him, his part of the story is within here as well. The bit where they've got the director, Adam, the bit where they're saying, trying to control who he has into his film and control the aspects of the film could be a direct reflection to him as well. All the struggles he's had in the past. Look at June and stuff like that. They could have easily just gone, you're doing this, you're having that, this is what's happening.
Yeah, yeah.
I think that's the whole point. One of the big points of which David Lynch is trying to stress is the corruption with Hollywood as well. And, you know, the nepotism, the Harvey Weinsteins, I know it was in her dream to convince her the reason she didn't get the job is, in other words, I don't play like them games like Camilla does. If I love someone, I love someone. I'm not just going to treat them like that just to get where I want. And there must be this evil world of Hollywood as well, governing everything. Well, I think on the other side is, I think David Lynch believes that is still there. And that was prevalent like that when David Lynch was growing up. That was Hollywood. You know what I mean? You literally had to sign a contract. You were there for 3 or 4 films. And you had to sign your life away. And if they didn't like you, you was gone. And no other place would look after you. So I think that still exists. I think it still comes out of the woodwork that still exists. And I think he wanted to make that known. It wasn't just her dream. I think that happens, shit like that. I tell you what, don't you think it's perfect sandwiched on to the back of watching Twin Peaks? Of all his films, this one more or less fits.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, much better. You could see that it was part of this world of which he was building with Twin Peaks. He had it in his head that this was going to be part of it.
Well, wasn't it originally, the original idea that this was essentially going to be actually an offshoot of Twin Peaks and it would feature Audrey Horne?
Yeah.
It was what would happen to Audrey Horne if she'd gone to Hollywood and stuff like that.
As it goes on and Rita starts realising more and more and they find out possibly where she lives and all that kind of stuff, and it's quite a tense scene, all that sort of bit, until the point where they're covering their noses and they find the body, which I think the body's probably Rita or Camilla on the bed, you know, the body on the bed that they find. Is that her?
I think it's her thinking of suicide in her own head.
Yeah.
Because it's the same position as well. Is there a room as well? And when the cowboy, you notice when the cowboy comes in to like wake her up at that point, she is in that same, exactly same position of the body that they found.
I get that too. And I think that maybe in the dream world, it might well have been her discovering the body of Camilla, subconsciously. But also it was the suicide. There was definitely a suicide part of all this. But she knew, I think, When she wakes up and she's having basically a nightmare and everything's going bad, and she's driven by guilt. She's driven by guilt to kill herself. She knows it's going to happen.
Yeah.
And she knows that God is right next to that blue box. So that's why that blue box is so important. I thought it was an odd choice that there was a triangular key fit this blue box.
Yeah.
Until I thought the fact that, like, there's three of them in this relationship. There's Diane, there's Camilla, and there's Adam.
Yeah.
And so it's a three-sided key, because that's the three sides of all this.
Gee, that's brilliant, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not even going to go into the painting that you see in your apartment. I'm not even going to go into that.
Why?
One.
No, go in, go in.
It's like saying I've got a secret they're not telling someone. Come on.
It's like I've got a third nipple or something. Go
on. there's a scene where Betty and Rita are sat on the couch and she's trying to help her and trying to persuade her that we should go and see Diana Selwyn and all that sort of thing. And directly between them in the shot on the back wall is a painting which is called, it's of Beatrice Cenci in, I think it was 17th century Italy or something like that. She was a victim of incestuous abuse from her father, and she had people kill him as a result of that. So, and she was eventually, she was hanged for that as well, or otherwise killed. So, I mean, why, that picture, nobody knows what that picture, when you're watching the film,
yeah.
Unless you're very much in the know, you don't know that that picture is what it's about. But that picture is framing the whole of Betty's story. She's a victim of abuse, like Laura Palmer was. It's the same story.
It does go into incest, David Lynch, a lot, really. It keeps a lot.
I don't know if it's incest, but it's certainly abuse.
Yeah. I think there must be some kind of connection within either an uncle or granddad, or she's running away from something. She doesn't really talk about her mum or dad. Because there's also, I read a good part where, you know, when she does the acting role, and then she sheds a tear with it at the end. That was her reflecting her views about that time. And that's why she did it so powerfully.
Well, yeah, that was all for the insinuation, wasn't it, in that scene that they'd been having this affair for a while.
Yeah.
And there's, what, a 20 or 30 year difference between them.
Yeah, yeah.
So
that could actually be her uncle or her father or something.
Well, it's kind of implied that the old couple, the happy ones that are lovely at the start, but go away looking evil. I think they're also the same ones that scare her onto the bed at the very end.
Yeah.
So the implication is that the granddad has been abused.
And the grandmother must have known about it and just ignored it.
The grandmother's doing very, very much Sarah Palmer in this situation. That's why they're the little monsters that come out of the blue box.
Yeah, because she's always got them. I mean, that's always her little guilt ridden. She can't get rid of that and chases
it. In her fantasy, they're lovely and say goodbye to her at the airport. Like, but as soon as they're away from her, in the actual capture, they turn into these evil.
I was going to ask a question. I was going to ask a question about that that awesome scene where she's being awesome as an actress with the old dude. The audition. Is he called Bob, the guy they keep having to wake up?
Well, that's the same Bob as was at the dinner party. She says, the director, I went for an audition, he didn't pick me, because implying that... And then in her fantasy, Bob is the guy in this audition who is crap and a bad director.
Yeah.
Not paying attention and not really...
Yeah.
Doesn't have a clue what's going on.
Not really
there. He tries to explain what he wants and everybody's like, all right, mate, we'll just do it ourselves. So that Bob is that's why he'd be worked into the dream as an inept, in the same way that the assassin is inept, because it's... what she wants, it fulfills her little personal narrative, her little fantasy.
Yeah. Oh my God, it's unreal, isn't it? Like, I was just trying to think about this. If this had been done kind of linear, from the point of view as in it starts with what we're calling reality into the dream, I mean, obviously it wouldn't have been as good a film, because we wouldn't be able to talk about it for as long as we have been, you know, that kind of thing. And I don't know why I thought, what if you'd have made this a linear film? It would have been worse, but would it have been a good... Could you make it, I'm not saying a good film, but could you make it a...
I think it is a linear film. I do think it is a linear film, because right at the start you see... aside from the jitterbug bit, which is just kind of the history. But as soon as her head hits the pillow,
she's dreaming.
Seeing that very first scene, that's the dream.
Yeah.
And then she wakes up, and then that's the rest of it.
Fair point. Sorry,
you could make it more obvious as a film, as a linear piece, I think, what you're saying, is to have her wake up, I mean, see her in what is the real world, and then go back. But then, that completely dispels what he's trying to see. He wanted you to think which one is the dream. And then once you find out which one is the dream, it's because you've come so attached to it as that.
You've just watched an hour and 50 minutes of
which
a film
is,
and invested
which,
that
to
time.
Which, to be honest, could be complete and utter bullshit. You know what I mean? When I have a dream and I'm king of the castle, You know what I mean? Doesn't mean I'm kicking a castle in fucking Salford or anything. So there's a lot in there, and you left. He's sort of taking a mickey for his audience. He's took you in. He's told you who she is. He's told her this life story, and then all of a sudden you've gone, no, this is her. You're like, whoa.
But has he though? Because he tells you very clearly at the start that this is a dream.
Yeah, he does tell you that it's a dream. But then how much of the elements of the dream are real and isn't real? You know what I mean? As you're going through, so you start challenging yourself. It's like, well, is she really from this place? Is she, you know what I mean? Is she maybe working in the diner? Did she even try and push herself to do any more? She fell in love with this one person and she did a. She went a bit wild.
Who fucked her over?
Who fucked her over? Well, there's no excuse to fucking have her killed.
I was going to say, there are limits. You're allowed to fuck people over.
It's a bit dramatic, but you know, it's a film in it and that.
Yeah.
But I was just sort of thinking it from that point of view, you know. I just mean, would it be? I think you could take this and make it into an awesome kind of thriller.
Yeah.
Like a normal sort of just cool film, but this is what takes Lynch the absolute and utter next level is this.
Yeah.
You know, and people that, you know, I'm not saying I get it, but I respect it and I love it. And I think it's just a fascinating journey. I can go back and watch it again and again. And I just love that with anything on a television.
I think you've hit the nail on the head. You can take it how you want to take it, and you're perfectly right.
All of these things
I've been spouting, they're just theories. They're not necessarily right, but they do fit a pattern.
Yeah.
What doesn't necessarily mean that was what he intended, but it's still valid as, in my head, this is how it happens.
But this is the beauty of doing a podcast like this. It's not like you're not right or wrong. It's great. It's one of the only things you can talk about where you're not right or wrong. It's not an argument or whatever, and it's sort of not a review. It's just like an interpretation of what you've seen.
Exactly.
Which makes it nice for a podcast, to talk about that.
What's beautiful about the Lynch movies is, like, I did a movie the other day with my brother and a friend of mine, The Warriors, the classic 1979 film. And you know what you're getting straight away. And each one of you can't really interpret it any other way than it is. You know what I mean? But you get a Lynch film, and my God, you can go in and out. I've done a list here of different people's types of theories just on this. And one of them is, at no point within the context of her talking to the hitman, he's just left to presume that she's asking him to kill him. She doesn't ask him. She just says, here's a picture. She could be asking him to do something else. Who knows what she is asking? It's just been left
I sort of thought a little bit it would be Adam. But then obviously, work out it's not necessarily that. But it's a cool thing, isn't it? It's nice. And what I think is anyone that says any part of a Lynch film is shit, there's a lot of people say stuff is shit.
Yeah.
You know, don't they?
Yeah.
Then you can't say it's shit. It's like saying, oh, that song's shit. You know, if it's some pop fucking bullshit.
Yeah,
it is shit because no fucking thought's gone into it apart from my records am I going to sell, or how many seats am I going, you know, how many bums am I going to put on seats at the theatre, that kind of thing, you know, like Marvel. Mm. But like with this, it's, even if you're not keen on that scene, there's a reason for it there. There's a reason for everything in this film, visually, musically, script wise, and that's why nothing is shit. You can never say that, but you can dismiss stuff that's shit. Like I said, it's just processed crap.
Yeah, like you said, the sound in this film is absolutely incredible. It's terrifying as well. We're not just talking Angelo Badalamenti's music, which is top atmospheric brilliance, but this, when all the bad things are happening, the rushing noises, the general sort of ominous deep sort of throbbing noises that happen, and it perfectly just picks you up and plonks you where it wants to in terms of, this is what I want you to feel right now.
This is what he does with Angelo. Like, Angelo'll sit at a piano and Lynch will set the scene and he'll be saying, like, you know, there's a moon and it's a dark night and there's an owl, and he sort of do it and he's like, yeah, keep them chords. So he does the chords and on the synths and things, and then he'll go into his recording software and he'll record 20 long chords of sounds on different instruments, cellos, violins, bassoons, whatever. And he'll record all this on Pro Tools. So do like 20 tracks, different instruments, just long notes. That's it. And then he gives the Pro Tool, the file to David, and he'll just go through the things. He'll slow them down, make them backwards, and that's what he uses for the tension things and all that kind of stuff. Whereas Angelo came up with a theme tune for Mulholland Drive because he was like, I want a kind of Soviet Cossack kind of thing. And it's just, it's amazing for people to work on that level. And that's what works really well with these two, because Lynch is going through with Angelo the scene, and then Angelo's getting it, he gets in his, they're in each other's heads.
Yeah.
It's such a beautiful relationship, which, I mean, the music they've created together is unreal. Unreal. Like, it's just, it could be cheesy because it's synth, and it's not. It's just fucking beautiful. I mean, these guys,
unique.
It's unique.
Completely. But that's what they do. That's what he does. Angelo, he sends him a file, and off he goes. He plays around with all this stuff he's done.
He doesn't leave him to it, though, does he? That's the great thing. David Lynch seems to have his fingers in every single thing he does.
I tell you what, though, I've recently got into his. He does a little video every day about the weather. There's a little 2-minute video saying what the weather's like today.
Yeah.
In LA, it's just nuts. But I mean, everything he does is like tinged with like layers and depths and meaning.
I love his voice though, the way he talks. You know, because it's the character of Gordon. But the character of Gordon in Twin Peaks that he plays is just basically an exaggerated version kind of him. You know, like if he was deaf. But I just, there's something just. Oh my God, he's a magical man. He really is. Yeah. And I love watching him and the way he puts things across. In, it could be construed as being a bit fucking hippie bollocks, but the way he puts it across, it's not. And he puts it across in layman's terms to a degree as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
To give you some sort of understanding of the creative process. Like, not obviously, you know, telling you what the film's about and stuff, but he is a unique and brilliant man, and the more I'm going down the Lynch hole, shall we call it?
Yeah.
It's just, I was crying in an interview that him and Naomi were doing, and when I was watching it today, because it was just like...
Was you really that interview, an interview with them?
Yeah, with them two.
You see that? Yeah, I pretty much welled up watching that as well.
It's just unreal. Like, it was kind of like a joy sadness, but a joy of this being introduced into my life. And the thing is, it could be inaccessible and it could be perceived to be pretentious, but it's not.
No, it's absolutely not.
Well, you could take it that way. You know, you could be a cunty fucking film critic for The Guardian. But
like everything, you can interpret everything that Lynch does in any way. Yeah. You can interpret it pretentious if you want. It means nothing.
But when you got three sort of normalist lads who are doing a podcast and coming out with all this sort of stuff, it's like, it's accessible. You know, we're not fucking film critics for The Guardian or whatever, you know what I mean?
We're not film critics either.
We're not fucking Quentin Cunting Tarantino.
Jesus Christ.
I'm still reeling.
I still reel. I do that all the time.
Lads, get over it. We need to have all sorts of people. Not every film can be David Lynch or nobody's watched films anymore.
Come back when you're old enough, Quentin.
You say we got together and we do David Lynch films, right? That's what we do. This is the Lynch Mob. That's our thing. We analyse one of his films. Try just watching one and that's it. Try just watching one only and just say, only watch it once. It's impossible. You have to watch it again. If anything, I'm ashamed that I didn't watch it a third time before we had the pod.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, it's still stuff I really want to delve into. And then you start looking, then you start analysing who he's working with.
I mean, it becomes a little bit too much. Like you say, I wanted to watch it again. And I think it was the big first watch of the big throw of the last half hour.
Yeah.
That's when you try to correlate, you know, the different personas of people, what's going on, and you don't, you know, it's hard to... It's quite a short bit, that last bit, isn't it? I'm not saying it's rushed, but it's a lot happens in half an hour, then you've got to correlate that to the rest of the film, and it's like, whew, you know, you need to, that's probably the bit you need to watch the most kind of thing, you know?
Well, it's a lot richer a thing that he produces than a lot of other things that you consume. A lot of films these days, once you've watched them, you kind of understand them. There's no urge to go back and try and find out any little details. Unless you're a mega fan of something, there's no particular need to do so. But every Lynch film that I've seen, every Lynch thing that I've seen, cannot be watched once and left. You can, but you'll miss out on so much.
Yeah, so many layers. Yeah.
It's not everything he does that has rewatchability that like nothing I've ever seen before. It totally... I mean, I used to find myself thinking... about Mulholland Drive during the day.
Yeah.
Just thinking, I wonder what that meant. And then, like, oh, maybe we have a revelation or something. I'll send a message to Cliff and stuff like that. So just I've had an idea about this, but it could be that. But nothing, no other thing that I consume, aside from maybe some books that I've read in the past, have that ability to keep you entertained many, many hours and days after you've actually watched the film.
Exactly. I think that's amazing. One of the reasons as well, apart from that we're all busy, that we couldn't do one a week. Because it'd be too fast. It'd be too fast to watch one and then analyse it, because you need time.
Totally right.
Like, I've still got stuff written here which I've not said. I sent a picture to John before, and it shows the driving up to that club Silencio. But as they drive up, there's a parking lot, so there's parking bays here. One says parking bay 8, but the way they've done the 8 is in front of you. Now, if you're parking up, you'll be parking on a sign and going in, so that 8 would turn to an infinite sign. So is he saying that if this is in a loop? Is what you're watching as a continuous loop?
Well, yeah, it is, because it starts, the tiny.
It could be nothing, but I just, like John knows, when I watch it, I'm looking at numbers constantly, and I'm like, what's that? And then I had a look online, and someone else had spotted it already, twats. I always think I'm quite special.
Always. Always.
Well, I think, that is the enjoyable thing, isn't it? Like we're sort of saying about Lynch films, is that the theories are enjoyable. Yeah. And no, I mean, I've not really gone on the internet and, you know, seeing what people say, because a lot of the time, and not with necessarily Lynch, it does my head in, where people sometimes their opinions are a bit horrible and things like that.
Yeah.
But I think most Lynch fans, it's lovely. The theories are shared and the designs sort of go, fuck yeah. And then what about this? You know, that's the sort of beauty.
So clever.
So have we decided which Lynch film we're going to do next, so we can tell the listeners in advance?
We decided this already.
Inland Empire.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, so we're going to do that one next, which is...
That's kind of his latest film, isn't it?
Yeah, 2006.
That's his last film.
2006.
Yeah, 2006. So that's also the year he got divorced as well. So let's see if something like that has an influence within the body of the film. Sometimes directors do that. That'd be good. So yeah. Inland Empire, that'll be a good one to watch. So we'll watch that one next. Bob, you got any last words before we sign off as another Lynch Mob?
Good, thanks again, man. It was like, this is a beautiful head fuck of a journey. It's great. It's the best way to fuck your head that's not drugs.
Yeah, that's true.
and drugs don't enhance it, believe me. They send you fucking loopy with you watching this shit. Oh, there was one question I forgot to ask. Is that the arm stood up behind a man? You know, is the mafia head or whatever? Is that the arm's head on top of
No, it's the same guy.
Yeah. No, is the same actor. Know. But the same actor stood behind a chair.
I don't know. Maybe.
Oh, yeah. You know what? I never looked at it that way. I'm gonna zoom into that one.
His face looks like the arm. The guy that plays the arm.
It is that guy. Yeah.
Yeah.
John, do you want a last word?
Well, you know, this film is, like I say, it is now currently and without a doubt my favourite film I've ever seen. Everything that I'm finding in this Lynch Mob thing is utter gold, and my life has been enriched immeasurably by having to share it with you guys.
Yes.
And so, yeah, all power to it. Long may it continue, apart from the fact that there's a limited green filmography to go through, but so it has to end eventually.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Okay, and we'll leave it there now. Thank you very much, everybody. That's been another Lynch Mob. Thank you.